All right, if you have your Bibles, go with me to Ephesians chapter 1. And I want to talk with you about, it's all about the blood. I want you to get a handle on some things about what God is doing. And there's a scripture that says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding. And all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. Now that's the essence of what I'm trying to say to you. That, of course, comes out of Proverbs, I think. But you want to keep that in the center of what we're trying to move here. We want to be in the center of what God is doing. And we want to trust Him. All right, let's go to Ephesians, okay? I'm going to read it from the Message, starting in chapter 1. I, Paul, am under God's plan as an apostle. Now catch, again, I'm reading from the Message, but I want you to see how clear it puts it. I am under God's plan. He knew about the book.
Amen.
I am under God's plan as an apostle, a special agent of Christ Jesus, writing to you faithful Christians in Ephesus. I greet you with the grace and peace poured into our lives by God, our Father, and our Master Jesus Christ. How blessed is God, and what a blessing He is. He's the Father of our Master Jesus Christ and takes us to the high places of blessings in Him. Long before He laid down earth's foundation, He had us in mind. Glory to God. Just what I've been saying. He had us in mind. Listen, He had settled on us. Glory to God. He had settled on us as the focus of His love. To be made whole and holy by His love. Before you showed up, He'd made up His mind. I'm going to love them. They will be my family. They will be my family. Everyone. God said, I love them. They will be my family. I've already made my mind up. The focus of my love is on them. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Long, long ago, He decided to adopt us into His family through Jesus Christ. What pleasure He took in planning all of this. We're talking about God the Father, y'all. We're talking about the Ancient of Days. The great I Am that I am is having a great time planning what He's going to do with your life and how He's going to bring you into His family and sit you at the right hand of the Father. Glory to God, and make everything under your feet. Glory to God. Whoa. All right. He wanted us to enter into the celebration of His lavish gift giving by the hand of His beloved Son. Now pay attention. The Father likes to lavish. He likes to pour out gifts on His children. That's on you, on me. The Father likes to give you gifts. He loves to do it. And He does it through the blood of His Son, Jesus. He's got it done. You're right. It's paid for. It's a finish. It is finished. Father, it is finished what you wanted me to do. I got them. That's what Jesus was saying. It's finished. I got them. Hell did not get me. I got hell under my feet. I got the key. And I got your children for you. Whoa. Hell didn't get them. I got them. I got them.
Amen. Thank God. Thank God.
took us to the Father. And then said, I know they're going to mess up, but your blood will forever cry out before the throne. The blood never stops talking. The blood never stops speaking your name. No matter what hell does, Jesus is just saying, the blood. The blood. The accuser of the brethren who just goes around. You shouldn't do that for them. You shouldn't do that for them. They did this. I know this about it. They did this in darkness. They grew up this way. They did that. They hated so-and-so. They talked about so-and-so. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And in the meantime, you have come. Lord, forgive me for doing all of that. And the devil is still up there saying, Daddy, they did this, they did this. And Jesus says, my blood took care of it. Jesus has never lost a battle. Nor will he. How can he lose when the one who's battling has already lost? Glory to God. That's why you want to make sure you're asking, show me something in me that I need to repent of. So the devil won't pull one on you. Show me. Father, show me. Make known to me. Holy Spirit, make it clear. What is it? Where have I been mad and didn't let it go? What did I take from childhood? What have I got so deep in me that it hurts too much to even go there? Let me be willing to deal with it and plead the blood over it and repent of it. That whether I did it or it was done to me makes no difference. Because the blood takes care of all of it. You see why the joy of the Lord should be our strength? Do you understand? Hell cannot get anything on us as long as we appropriate the blood. Now, when you don't, and you won't deal with you, and you won't deal with your attitudes, because attitudes get us in big problems. Big problem. Pride, whoa, goes before a fall. I mean, we should be the most humble people and at the same time, the most assured people that ever walked on the face of the earth. Glory to God. What am I sure of? I belong to Jesus. Hallelujah. And hell, you can't have me. You can't have me. And I'm not here just to, to dance morning, noon, and night. I'm here to do something for the kingdom. And until I take my last breath, I'm going to be asking, Father, what can I do for the kingdom? What's in that book I missed? Bring that thing back up. What did I miss? Where did I charge off my way without even talking to you about it? Oh, thank you. Okay. Because of the sacrifice of the Messiah, verse 7, I think. Because of the sacrifice of the Messiah, his blood poured out on the altar of the cross, we are a free people. Free of penalties and punishments chalked up by all of our misdeeds. Now, grab hold of this. They are chalked up. Did you get that? So don't think there's not a record of our misdeeds. Right here says there is a record where you and I messed up. There is a record where we haven't forgiven. There is a record of all of it. But, hallelujah, if we come and repent and apply the blood of Jesus, that record is nailed to the cross and it doesn't exist anymore. Do you know how absolutely stupid it is for you and I if you have repented? And repenting means change, turn, go another way. Don't keep doing it, go a different direction. If you and I have really repented, do you understand how stupid it is that we continue to repent over and over and over again as if the blood was not sufficient? Amen. Amen. And not just barely free, abundantly free. He thought of everything. Listen to this. The Father thought of everything, provided for everything we could ever possibly need, letting us in on the plans He took such delight in making. The Lord liked writing your book. He liked the little things He had in there for you. I know the thoughts I have, they're good. They're good thoughts, good thoughts. He set it all out before us in Christ, a long-range plan in which everything would be brought together and summed up in Him, everything in deepest heaven, everything on planet Earth. It's in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. If you don't know Jesus, you have no earthly idea why you are alive. I have no purpose. That's because you have no Savior. Hallelujah. Because if you have a Savior, accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you got a purpose.
Through the years, there have been many different phases of spiritual warfare taught in the church. The problem has been that most of these have been based on the things we thought we had to do in order to help God win. In essence, there was no sound biblical basis for our belief or actions. In the 4-CD series, Biblical Spiritual Warfare, Sandra brings clarification by teaching the biblical principles of spiritual warfare. Call and request offer 142 or order online.
It means you have not appropriated His salvation for you. It means it's not real to you. Jesus loves you. He has a plan for you. We're talking about the plan. And people all over, the whole, I'm telling you, millennial crowd, all of them, everybody, everywhere. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I don't know who I am. I have no purpose. I have no destiny. They don't know the Lord. And if they do know Him and they may know about Him, and maybe they have asked Him into their life, but they have never moved in to wanting to walk in the center of His will. They have never realized His love for them. That's the deal. They have never realized that the Father has a plan for your life that's different than anybody else that's ever lived. And only you can do it. Or maybe somebody else would, no. Only you can do it. Only you. There's things that only you can do. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And then he says, He set it all out before us in Christ, a long-range plan. We've already talked about that. It's in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. Long before we first heard of Christ, I'm just doing chapter 1, so don't get nervous. Long before we first heard of Christ and got our hopes up, He had His eye on us, had designs on us for glorious living. Now, if you're not living gloriously, you're not reading His part of the book. Isn't that what it says? He had designs on us for glorious living, part of the overall purpose He is working out in everything and everyone. He has great things planned. Well, ain't no great thing in my life. Well, maybe you're writing a book instead of reading the book. That's the problem. You're writing it and wanting Him to approve it. He's not going to do it. It's in Christ that you, once you heard the truth and believed it, found yourselves home free, signed, sealed, and delivered by the Holy Spirit. Whoa!
Glory to God!
signed, sealed, and delivered to our home in heaven. Hallelujah! Once you found out who Jesus really is, once you will take his love, once you will receive him into your heart, once you want to work with him, once you just want him to have you, it is no longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. Have your way in my life. You are signed, sealed, and delivered to the Father. Whoa! Hallelujah. And I'm not talking about when you die. I'm talking about now. Hallelujah. This signet from God is the first installment, the Holy Spirit, is the first installment on what's coming. A reminder that we all get everything God has planned for us, a praising and a glorious life. Amen. How many glorious lives we got in here? Amen. Don't be waving your hand when I know how you do. The blood, right? The blood. That's the answer. That's why when I heard of the solid truth you have in the Master Jesus and your outpouring of love to all the Christians, I couldn't stop thanking God for you. This is Paul. Every time I prayed, I'd think of you and give thanks. But I do more than that. I ask, Paul says, I ask the God of our Master, Jesus Christ, the God of glory, to make you intelligent. Yes, thank you, Lord. And discerning, yes, Lord, and knowing him personally. So that's what Paul's praying for us. So which means you can pray for it. Lord, give me discernment. Lord, make me intelligent. Give me wisdom. Give me understanding. You know, enlightenment. Your eyes focused and clear, yes, so that you can see exactly what he see what it is he's calling you to do. Now, we need to know what it is Jesus is calling us to do. Amen. And Paul is saying, you pray for this, and the Lord will show you exactly what you're supposed to do. Grasp the immensity of this glorious way of life he has for Christians. Oh, the utter extravagance of his work in us who trust him. Endless energy, boundless strength.
Amen.
Now, the key here is who trust him. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. This is where I started. But the key is trust. The key is trust. Trust him. Believe him. Take him at his word. Trust. That's what faith is. Remember, this is a faith kingdom. You and I are part of a new kingdom. It's a faith kingdom. Everything we get by faith. Everything God has given, this already been given, but you have to take it by faith. You have to make it yours by faith.
Amen.
Or you won't have that suit. You won't have it. All this energy, verse 20, all this energy issues from Christ. God raised him from death, set him on a throne in deep heaven, in charge of running the universe. Everything from galaxies to governments. No name, no power exempt from his great rule. And not just for the time being, but forever. He's in charge of it all, has the final word on everything. At the center of all this, Christ rules the church. Are you listening? Christ rules the church. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. The church is more important than the world. And the next sentence says it all. The church is Christ's body in which he speaks and acts, by which he fills everything with his presence. Through the church, everything, only through the church, is everything filled with the presence of God. So if we do not walk out the book, we do not live for him, if we do not bow to him, we do not move with him, then we are not allowing the presence of God to invade a place. And the presence of God always changes everything. So God's presence is not going to get there unless the church gets it there. You got to get this. God's got your number, whether you have his or not. And everything, you're talking about a tracking system. Heaven has quite a tracking system on you and on me. We can laugh about it, but everything you do is tracked. Angels keep records on all of us. That's why we need to be praying, God, show me what I need to repent of so that you will never have to face it again. And if the Lord does not bring it up to you, then that falls on the Lord. But if it comes to you, it's you that has to repent and claim the blood of Jesus. So if something doesn't come up, you obviously have repented of it somewhere, sometime. So don't sit around trying to dig it. Just quietly sit and let him bring it. He can bring a carload at one time. And we need to ask, I want to know what I need to repent of. And plead the blood over. I'm not going to worry about you and your repenting. I'm worried about me and mine. Because when I get to heaven, there's not a line. I'll get over there. They look like they're repenting better than the others. No. Mm-mm. We're supposed to be repenting before we get there. So I'm suggesting to you, as I'm suggesting to me, there is a book. And it's all about the blood. My book, I can tell you this right now, is bloodstained.
Hallelujah.
Because of the kind of life I've lived and things I've done and the things I've repented of, my book's bloodstained. Thank God it's bloodstained. Because I've repented.
Amen.
And the blood has covered it.
Amen.
And I am sure it's going to be more blood on it. I thank God that the blood is available.
Yes.
For when I mess up.
Yes.
I thank God. Because it's one thing to go to the Father and have a book with all what he thinks about you. And then to have this other page over here. That's just what you did. And to go up and say, well, I just did it my way. Your way won't even get you into heaven. Oh, it will get you to the great white throne judgment. It will. But there is a judgment seat of Christ. And that's where the books are brought out for us. Let's pray for the blood to cover all our books.
Yes.
Amen. For the blood to cover everything that's out of order.
Yes.
Everything that's out of order in our life. The blood of Jesus. Lord, thank you. Thank you for the blood. Thank you for forgiving us and not holding it against us. And thank you for the ability that you just put us back on track. Thank you. We're living in end days. And we need to be where you want us to be. Doing what you want us to do. It should be the most important thing in our entire lives right now.
Through the years, there have been many different phases of spiritual warfare taught in the church. The problem has been that most of these have been based on the things we thought we had to do in order to help God win. In essence, there was no sound biblical basis for our belief or actions. In the 4-CD series, Biblical Spiritual Warfare, Sandra brings clarification by teaching the biblical principles of spiritual warfare. Call and request offer 142 or order online.
You know, the Sunday morning that I taught this message on, it's all about the blood. I'm telling you, the Spirit of the Lord just came into the church. We were so excited. I mean, the presence of God, it was wonderful. And to think what God has already done for us, all because of the blood. And if you and I could just understand that it's taken care of, it truly is finished. And that we don't have to fight this fight. All we have to do is fight a good fight of faith. Just believe that what Jesus did was sufficient and was all that we needed, all because of the blood of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. And our offer, our special here, called Biblical Spiritual Warfare, this particular 4 CDs will absolutely change your life forever, because it's a different approach. Taking the Bible and coming at what the Bible gives you specific ways to win the spiritual warfare. Well, not to win it. Jesus has already won it. How to agree with Him. How to stay with Him. How to stand with Him. This will really bless you. I hope you'll call in and get it. And I hope you'll call in. Remember, the people answering the phone, they're our folks. They're here. Remember, we have a healing center here where people from all over the world come. To our healing explosions, they come to be a part of. And you just need to go to our social media to find out when our next healing explosion is, find out what conference we're in, because we're going to be in Dallas on September the 14th. And we'll be teaching at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. there at Christ for the Nations. Hope you'll come be a part of it. Oh, it's just wonderful what God is doing. Partner with us. We're out to change the world. For the Lord Jesus Christ, He is wonderful.
Through the years, there have been many different phases of spiritual warfare taught in the church. The problem has been that most of these have been based on the things we thought we had to do in order to help God win. In essence, there was no sound biblical basis for our belief or actions. In the 4-CD series, Biblical Spiritual Warfare, Sandra brings clarification by teaching the biblical principles of spiritual warfare. Call and request offer 142 or order online.